Hello everyone. Hi, Professor Kumar.
Good morning.
Good morning, Professor Jane.
Good morning.
Good morning, Jen.
Good morning. How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing well, thanks.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Of course. Thank you for the invitation. Always a lot of fun to visit Illinois. And like the best part of my job is hanging out with students and postdocs. So this is like my favorite activity, my favorite way to spend my day. And it's right in between team meetings and administrative stuff. So it's the perfect kind of fun interlude. I made a dozen slides. And so so if you want, yeah, that'll probably be 10 minutes or so. But I can even keep that shorter.
Of course, yes. I'm gonna make you a co-host so you can also share your screen. And I'm gonna wait for a couple more minutes to allow more people to join us. And then I'm gonna introduce you to the audience and then you can start your presentation. Sounds great?
Perfect. Now, remind me, you're mostly or all in engineering, is that right?
That's right, yes. Our SciNet group, it's actually an interdisciplinary group. We are from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, and Professor Kumar is our PI in the SciNet group. And this is one of the activities of the Junior Scientist Council. So it's a bunch of grad students and young scientists working all together towards these kind of activities to, yeah, help us improve our communication skills and also to learn more about mentoring and a bunch of stuff.
That's great. Those are all such important skills.
Yeah, but the students are from pretty much many disciplines, not just engineering. So.
A lot
of people on geology, biochemistry, geography, earth and planetary science. So the critical zone allows us to basically, or the goal is to bring together people from all the disciplines to work together. So.
Yeah, we also have people from Nebraska, from Tennessee, from all over the country. Yes.
Very cool. I think this is something that I would love to see change nationwide in graduate education is just to have, yeah, think about better ways to provide this professional development content. So it's fantastic that you're doing this. I think it's something where this, everything I see, almost everything is like student-led efforts and I think the students are just tearing it up with like kind of demanding, just saying like, we need these skills and we're gonna find ways to like make this happen. But at the same time, I'm like, man, what if faculty like, you know? So yeah, so Professor Kumar, you're kind of sponsorship and leadership of the group is really great. I wish more faculty kind of got on board with just doing
that. Yeah, I mean, the students are running on their own. We just basically said, create a forum, and they're doing an amazing job. And this is what, only a couple of months old now? So I think this is pretty cool. So we're so excited about this.
Congratulations on your leadership, Layla, and any of your other co-leaders who are here.
Yeah, absolutely. This is an effort of all the students in the Scientist Council. So yeah, we are very, very happy and honored to have you here today, because this is actually our first coffee chat. So what a better way to start with you as our guest. So if everyone, I think most of the people are here, and okay, let's get it started. So hello everyone, and welcome to our coffee chat. My name is Leila Hernandez Rodriguez, and I am a four-year PhD student at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. This event is part of the outreach activities of the SciNet Junior Scientist Council. And today I am delighted to introduce Professor Jem Heemstra to our coffee chat. Actually, when I was looking at who to invite to our first coffee chat, I couldn't think on anyone else. So Professor Heemstra is currently an associate professor of chemistry at Emory University. She received her bachelor's degree in chemistry from the University of California at Irvine in 2000. Her PhD at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign in 2005, and a postdoc at Harvard University from 2007 to 2010. Many of you may know her from her work at Heemstra Lab at Emory University, and also others may know her from following her on Twitter. And that is a great space that she created, where she shares her opinion about mentoring, her experiences in academia, and in a very, also a very interesting topic, which is how we are more likely to succeed if we are willing to fail. So without further ado, welcome Professor Heemstra, and we are delighted to have you here today.
Thank you so much for that introduction, Leila, and thank you for the invitation. It's such an incredible honor to get to be here. I was saying as we were starting up, you know, the best part of my job is to spend time talking with students and postdocs and early career researchers. You're the future of science and engineering. And every time I spend time with early career researchers, I realize just how bright that future is. And so thank you for your leadership in organizing all of this and for the opportunity to join you. And I also realized that I'm interested in a lot of the topics that the SciNet group is interested in. I'll talk about one of those just for about 10 minutes today, but I'm happy to take questions on, you know, anything in the realm of kind of professional development. I'm really passionate about communication and leadership and mental health and policy and all of those things. So I look forward to a great discussion. So I'll keep my comments pretty brief. But as Leila mentioned, I'm also chasing the sun that comes through my window, so I'm gonna move a little bit. I'm interested in a lot of topics around professional development. Our group is as a whole, but this topic of failure is one that kind of goes an extra level for us, in that this has become, it actually became so embedded in the professional development of our lab that we realized a need to actually do education research in this area. And so I am currently the co-PI of a nationwide collaborative that's looking to advance practices, kind of teaching and instruction practices in this area of how we help students kind of become more resilient and cope with failure. But it really comes from my position leading a lab, and it really comes out of our group thinking about how we do research. And so I'll share that quickly, and then we can get to discussion. And so, why do we study failure? I probably don't need to convince anyone here why this is important, because, you know, as researchers, we know that failure is, you know, painful and unavoidable, but it's also usually a key step on the path to success. And so, and if you want to turn failure into an eventual success, you know, usually that requires perseverance and resilience. You need to be able to bounce back and keep trying better. And what something that occurred to us, you know, we started really realizing how important it was for us to think strategically about this in our lab. But what inspired our education project is realizing like, okay, well, you know, when, what in our undergraduate curriculum helps students develop these skills, right? Like, I never learned about perseverance and resilience taking chemistry classes, right? I learned how to convert grams into moles and how to push arrows, but I never really learned about how to overcome that. And so we've, I won't talk in specifics about it, but we've had an effort for the last few years of trying to create classroom practices for undergraduate instructors to really help students build resilience. But I want to talk today about, you know, really just why is this important to us as researchers and how do we kind of approach this idea of failure and, you know, learn how to cope with it as part of what we do. And so I like to say, you know, we all already know how to fail. We've all learned how to fail in different domains of our lives. You know, for me, it started playing golf. I've played golf since I was pretty young. I haven't gotten to play a lot in the last 10 years since I had kids, but right, golf is just like full of failure, right? So, you know, anyone else out there, maybe a few other people who learned about failure playing golf, or maybe golf. If not for golf. And actually golf is kind of fun and pretty effective way of thinking about failure, right? Because you know, you walk up to this hole and it's, you know, whatever, there's a windmill and all of these different crazy waterfalls and tubes you have to putt the ball through to get to the hole. And you're always, you know, success is like a hole in one, right? That's what you're always hoping for because it's possible. But sometimes it seems impossible. So, you know, what do we do about that? You know, most of us probably plan out what we think is the best option. You know, we do that to the best of our ability. You know, if you get that hole in one, you jump up and down or whatever and celebrate, high five. But if you're unsuccessful, you know, what do we do? Like, do we do this? You know, do you throw your putter in the bushes and go home? Yeah, this is like what, you know, my seven-year-old might do, but I think, you know, most adults probably don't do that. You know, rather you say, oh, shucks or darn it or whatever. And then you reassess and you say, okay, well, that didn't go as I wanted, but where am I at right now? What is now my best shot in light of what just happened? What's my best shot to bring this to a success? And then next time you play that hole, you're going to say, oh, last time I did this and it didn't work. So this time I'm going to try it a little bit differently. So, you know, it's, and this is coping with failure, but it's in a really, really small way. And there's something we can learn from it. You know, the challenge comes in then saying, okay, well, that's like putt-putt golf, right? And what about when it's my career is on the line? You know, it's a lot easier to kind of be like, oh, well, you know, whatever, I'm going to do, you know, I'm going to approach this with full force, even though I might fail. And then when I do fail, I'm going to just move forward as best I can. It's easier to do that when the thing you're doing is kind of low stakes and for fun. But I would argue that even when the stakes are higher, you know, we still don't want, you never want to fail. But if we can bring those same kind of running at something, even though you might fail, and coping productively when you do fail, if we can bring that same attitude into things, even when the stakes are high, this is where it can actually make us more successful. So, right, the stakes are higher when we think about failing in our research, because you need to succeed in your research to, you know, move on in your career. And what I hope to leave you with, though, is just this idea of, you know, why this still matters is that, you know, it isn't so much that failure is good, but overcoming fear of failure is good, because fear of failure can make you do things that actually make you more likely to fail. So fear of failure can make you not even try, you know, never set up the experiment or subtly sabotage it. Or avoid seeking out help and advice, right? You know, how often is our experiment more successful because we got less help and advice, right? You know, or make us less likely to try again? You know, how often are we more successful because we didn't try again or we didn't give it our best? And so, you know, we've been thinking in our lab, you know, again, about what do we do about this as researchers and educators? And I'll just go through this really quick. This is actually a really good conversation with my PhD advisor, Jeff Moore, who, if you actually work at the Beckman Institute, you probably know who that is. He's the current director of the Beckman Institute. And I was a graduate student with him in the chemistry department. And actually about 5 years ago, he was visiting for a seminar visit. And you know, he just casual conversation, he was like, hey, have you read this book, Mindset by Carol Dweck? I was like, yeah, what's that about? He goes, well, how you view your abilities can determine your success. And I was like, huh, I need to read that. And the thing that was like the total showstopper for me in reading this, that made me realize like, oh my goodness, we have to tackle this as a lab, is this idea that, you know, she talks about mindsets and that what she describes as the fixed mindset can create fear of failure. And this can make us self-sabotage. So we have an excuse when things don't work. And I was like, oh my goodness, I see myself doing this all the time. I lead a team of people where we're gonna fail like 90% of the time in our experiments. If we're self-sabotaging so that we have like a backstop for when we fail, like, oh my goodness, how much is that impacting our productivity, right? Like, what does this look like when we work in a place where we, you know, if we worked in like accounts payable where we're like, you know, managing spreadsheets and accounts and stuff and you don't fail very often, like maybe it doesn't matter. We do research, we fail like literally every day. And so how much could this be impacting our success? And so actually at our group retreat, this is about, 5 years ago, we did a session on this. And this is what started all this for our lab. And we talked about mindset. And I won't go into the details here. You might be familiar with it. If you're not, I highly, highly suggest reading the book. But basically, it all comes down to whether you view your abilities as fixed, like, okay, you are born with a genetically encoded set of capabilities in all these different domains. Or, you know, the growth mindset says, okay, you might be born with like certain things being easier for you than others. You know, there's certainly like for me, math came easily. Dancing did not. I have no rhythm, but I can think, you know, about math fairly easily. But what the growth mindset says is that your effort can produce a huge range around that kind of natural talent that you have. That effort, that range that's created by your effort can often, you know, swamp out the individual variations of what you're kind of naturally born with. And this has a huge impact then on how we approach failure. Because if you can't actually change your abilities, then if you fail, you're just stuck, right? It's like a brick wall. There's no path forward. But if you can grow your abilities, then a failure is just kind of a data point. You know, it says, okay, well, I didn't get it that time, but I can try again. You know, one of my favorite quotes comes from a rock climber and they say, failure is just a baseline for trying again. You know, it says, okay, I didn't get it that time. I need to do something different, but I can get better. And so, you know, it kind of is this idea of then when we fail in a lab, is it something that just becomes a roadblock to us or is it something that we can move past? And, you know, Carol Dweck kind of talks about this cascade of events that happens that turns this little assumption about your abilities into something like deciding to run an experiment or not, or deciding to get help or not. But I'll just give you kind of one example of what that looks like. And this is actually a slide I showed my group in that presentation that, you know, in this fixed mindset, you know, you might not have even tried the experiment in the first place. You know, again, you might have self-sabotaged it, so you have an excuse if it doesn't work. You know, one of the quotes from the book that just, you know, gets me to the core comes from a professional cellist, Nadia Salerno Sonnenberg. She said, you know, nothing is harder than saying I gave it my best and it wasn't enough. I'm like, oh, that one just gets, because, you know, if we're like, well, actually, you know, I kind of knew I was me. I kind of just, you know, whatever. But when you're like, no, I gave it everything I had, that's hard. And mindset plays into all of this. You know, in this fixed mindset, you know, when things go wrong, you kind of just go down this unproductive path of coping with it. Whereas from the growth mindset, you know, you can go into it thinking, okay, this may or may not work, but I'm going to try it. I'm going to give it my absolute best. You know, if it doesn't work, I'm going to view that as a challenge. You know, it's not a brick wall. It's something, it's a speed bump, you know, and trying again is worth it because you're going to learn. So if it's something failed, there's something we don't know, and you're going to learn something from that. And no matter what, you're going to grow in your knowledge and be a better researcher for it. And so, you know, if you stop and think then, you know, again, which of these pathways is more likely to lead to success? This really drives home the point that it isn't that failing is a good thing. But if we come into it with a mindset where we're willing to fail and we're willing to try our best, that can actually lead us down this more kind of productive psychological path of how we think about things. And so all that to say, yeah, you know, failure isn't the goal. You know, the goal is to succeed. But, you know, the goal is to have the courage to do our best, even when we might fail. You know, the wisdom to seek out help and advice, you know, before, during, and after a failure, to be able to go to someone and say, hey, my experiment failed. Can we talk about what I might do differently next time? To keep going and keep getting better. And, you know, I didn't talk about this, but how to kind of transform failure when it does happen into something that actually makes you stronger. And there's some really, really fascinating psychology on this as well. And that, yeah, kind of having that attitude of willingness to fail could be one of the things that really fuels your success. So with that, I'll stop and thank the people in my lab who are the reason why I do everything I do, because they are just so amazing and creative and driven and fun. And it's the joy of my job. And also, this is our collaborative, the last time we were able to meet in person, which sadly was about a year and a half ago. But hopefully we'll meet in person again someday. And so yeah, now we're a collaborative of I think a little bit over 200 members across the country trying to devise these interventions to benefit students and to deploy those in the classroom. And thank you again for the opportunity to be here, and I'm really excited for our discussion.
Thank you so much, Professor Heemstra. You were right on time. That's amazing. And I'm personally relieved that you are doing this effort to put this topic on the table and say, hey, this happens to everyone, and we are doing research on this, and we are learning how to deal with it, and we can talk about it. So that's amazing. And well, now we have about like 20 minutes to discuss and have some questions. So please raise your hand or send us your question to the chat box and we can read it. And yes, please remember that our session will end at 10:40. So yeah, let's get it started.
Let me ask a question. So hi, I'm Esther Lee. I'm a PhD student at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. And thank you for your great talk. It's a relief to hear that the failure matters and how to cope with the failure actually matters. So my question is, how do you motivate yourself and your students to come back from failure, especially to overcome the fear of failure in the future, and also transform the fixed mindset to growth mindset?
Oh, that's a really great question. Yeah, I think the second half of it is really one of the keys, which is that you know, the psychology behind it is kind of really getting at the root of what drives that fear of failure. And so if you can get that, you know, everything else kind of works out okay. And so, yeah, how you switch from the fixed mindset to the growth mindset. So Carol Dweck does a much better job than I could at talking about how to do that. But I think, you know, knowing about it and developing probably like most changes, you know, developing a self-awareness of that is the first step. So kind of understanding what are the things, what are the times when I've had a fixed mindset? A lot of those are around golf, actually, for me. You can understand kind of what's created that, and understanding what it looks like to have that growth mindset. And then I think a really, really huge one is that, you know, because it isn't like, oh, I've changed my mindset and now I'm all set. It's a constant process. It's like the probably best thing to tap into is, you know, kind of the process of like, how do we change our behavior? And it isn't like, oh, I change it once and I have a new habit, right? It's like, you have to do it constantly. It's realizing like, what triggers me to do something that I don't want to do? How can I recognize that? And what will I choose to do instead? And so for me, yeah, something I see a lot of, or a strategy I like to use and we talk about a lot is like, recognizing what are the fixed mindset thoughts that I have? When am I going to have those? And what are they going to be? And then how can I counter that and create a new narrative? And so for me, it might be something like one of the ones I still struggle with is like, I'll have an idea for a research project. And if it's in a really, really cutting edge, fast moving area, I'll catch myself saying, well, you know, that's something that like those really top scientists would do. And I'm just not one of those people. So I could never, you know, get that done timely enough that we could publish it before all the other, you know, really smart people get to it instead. And it's like, wait a sec, you know, and I recognize that. I think, no, why not? Why can't we do that? Why can't we, you know, we might fail, but why can't we at least give that a try? Or I'll catch myself doing, I do a subtle sabotage thing on my grant proposals. I'll be reading through a proposal, the final draft, and see something where I'm like, oh, actually that's like a little flaw in the design, or I could have, you know, I didn't really explain that quite as well as I wanted. And there's a small voice that will be like, oh, just keep it there, because leave it as it is, because then if you don't get it funded, you have an excuse. It's like, no, that's ridiculous. This needs to be the best it can be. And so I recognize that and think, no, I owe it to my lab to turn in the best proposal possible. And just finding, so I think recognizing those thoughts in yourself and then finding ways, you know, alternative kind of thought patterns to counter it with. You know, in fact, if anyone's familiar with like cognitive behavioral therapy, a lot of it is very similar to that as well.
Thank you.
That's a great question.
We have a question here in the chat from Vinny from Yogyakarta, Indonesia, on the other side of the globe. They say, thank you for a great presentation. I would like to ask why we should seek the wisdom even after the failure.
Yeah, that's a great question. It's great to see you, Vinny. It's great to see you again. Thanks for joining for this. So why seek wisdom even after a failure? And I think, you know, to me, it's the fact that you're probably going to hit another situation that's similar, you know, or there's always something to learn from a failure to try to do better the next time you're doing the same thing, or often the next time you're doing something that's a little bit different. There's still something we can learn and something we can grow from in almost every failure. And so, you know, something I do on a fairly regular basis, I actually do this like every day. I haven't been as good with like COVID and like all of our routines being disrupted, as I think through my day and even the small failures. And I always think like, okay, what went well today? What didn't go so well? What did I learn from that? Especially the things that didn't go well. What did I learn from that? And what would I do differently next time? And just even going through that, or having that, you know, if it's a bigger failure, having that debrief with other people of like, okay, what went wrong? What could I have done better? What did I learn from it? And what would I do next time? I think it's good on two levels. You know, one of those is that it just helps you be more likely to be successful in the future. It helps you gain some wisdom that you can use as you mentor others. But I think it's also, actually psychology shows us, it's really good and healthy for us as well, because if we can then turn that failure into an opportunity for growth and feel like, okay, I didn't get the outcome that I wanted, but I did still get some learning or growth out of it, it takes a little bit of that sting away. It wasn't just completely, you know, pointless pain or unnecessary pain. It's like, okay, well, yeah, that really, really stung to go through that, but I did learn something from it that I will take into the future to be more successful.
Hi, Professor. Thank you for the great talk. I'm Shenan Zhou, a PhD student from the University of Tennessee. I have a question: how to deal with overlook attitudes from colleagues, a lack of support and criticism, and how to overcome that and how to avoid that happening again? Thank you.
Oh, thanks. That's a good question. And if I caught it right, it's kind of like the negative attitudes and criticism from your colleagues or mentors. I'll start that by just saying that I'm so sorry you have to face that. I think this is one of the things, I mean, I know I need to grow still as a mentor in the sense of learning how to be more supportive. I think our, you know, the STEM field as a general and in general and in graduate education, we really need to think about how we do better at creating positive, supportive workspaces. So it's hopefully, you know, it's something that nobody should have to cope with, but at the same time we do. And, you know, I'm trying to think, gosh, how have I kind of coped with that? Or how have I seen other people cope with it? You know, there's kind of two strategies that I can think of that are kind of the major strategies for tackling this. And you can use both or kind of choose one or the other, depending on the particulars of the situation. You know, if the person who's being critical or unsupportive is someone who's pretty open to dialogue, you know, sometimes having dialogue with that person can be helpful. You know, something that I think is at the root of actually a lot of the challenges in our field is that as faculty, we're never really trained in how to be leaders and mentors. And so there's a lot of faculty who want to do better, but don't really even realize that they're, you know, not being helpful. And, you know, so if it's someone you can trust to have that conversation with, I think, you know, a good way to have that conversation is to, you know, just start with like, hey, you want me to be really successful? I want to be really successful. I want to work really hard here. You know, can we talk about something that would help me to be more successful here, which is, you know, can we talk about how to talk about, you know, things I could do better, and to really talk about how those conversations happen and what would, you know, the way to have those conversations, because we all need feedback about how we can do better, but it can be delivered in a way that's really constructive. So there's kind of tackling it to try to actually lessen the criticism or make it more productive. Well, there's actually three tactics. There's a tactic that's kind of only in you, and that is, this is so hard, and it shouldn't have to be on you to do this, but we, you know, all receive a lot of feedback that is not delivered particularly well. There's actually a book I love. I recommend this book a lot. It's called Thanks for the Feedback. And the subtitle is like, even when it's ill-timed, poorly delivered from the wrong person, and quite frankly, you're not in the mood or something. And it's actually a really good book about how to hear feedback and realize that there's always something useful in it. But often the way that people deliver it, like if there's a lot of cruelty or meanness or just critical negativity in it, that has more to do with them than you. And the more you can try to like kind of pull that layer off and see it for what it is, that can be helpful. Something I really, really highly recommend no matter what though, is to just really surround yourself with a group of supportive people that you can run these things by. Like when somebody tells me something about me that I think is inaccurate or cruel or overly critical, I have people who I can go to who I know will not pull punches with me. And I can say, hey, someone told me this about me. You know, do you think, like, I know I need to grow in this area, but is this accurate? And if it's an area where I really need to grow, I know that they'll be like, yeah, actually you could get better at that. You know, that wasn't delivered well, but I also know that, you know, sometimes they'll be like, no, that's total nonsense. And that person's being ridiculous and you should just not listen to it at all. But no matter what, they're people who are going to, you know, we're a group of people who build each other up and support each other, even when we tell each other hard things. And so having, you know, even if some of the people in your life aren't supportive, finding that group of people who are, and doing that for each other can be really, really, really valuable.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thanks for a great question.
Hi, Jen. My name's Roseanne. I'm a machine learning researcher, and I also run a nonprofit. So I have a question more about your career path, and because it fascinates me that you started from doing chemistry and then you sort of converged to this topic. And then I think in one of your talks, you mentioned that because you're a tenured professor, you can do anything you want and you're really passionate about this. That actually like sparkles in my head a little bit. So I was thinking for people like more like me and a lot of people I know who are an early career in research, we graduated from grad school, we're looking for a researcher position somewhere. So in machine learning, there's like industry labs you can join. There's academia, of course, always an option. But like all those paths are quite rigid. You join, you have a title and you have a job description, you do this kind of research. Of course, you know, once you grow to say tenure in academia or some director in an industry lab, maybe you have more freedom, but how do we do, like, how do we put our passion into the right place when our job sort of limits us on what we can do or cannot do in terms of research topics?
That's a great question. I mean, I will say that still most of our research is still chemistry. I'm actually at work today. And so you can kind of see behind me the pipes and stuff in our chemistry lab. So there are, you know, could I switch to being only an education research lab? That would probably still be a relatively difficult thing to do. But could I quit my job and go get a job as an education researcher? Like, maybe at this point, some of those things open up. So I think, some of it depends on, I think a really helpful thing to delineate is, you know, what do you want to be your main thing? You know, like to me, I love chemistry. I still love chemistry. And so I'm perfectly happy to have that still be the main thing that I do research on. And so staying as a chemistry professor is a great job, and I can do all the other things that I want to do on the side, because nobody tells me I can't. So that means I can do it. So, but if you hit a point where you discover, hey, yeah, the main thing I want to do is not this thing that I, you know, was hired to do, then I think that is a good time to think about career changes. And that takes a huge amount of courage. I mean, you talk about like overcoming fear of failure, to think about leaving the career that you've been in and going, charting out into something completely different and new is hard. And it takes a lot of boldness, but it's something that, you know, there's certainly a lot of really great role models of people who have done that. I'd say that until you know, as you're along the path, I think, you know, definitely, I know industry can be a little bit more constrained because, you know, you have to be doing the work for the company. You can do whatever you want, like in your spare time, but within your, you know, company work, it kind of has to be what they've approved. I'll say that in academia, I think that this is one of the things I love about academia is that there's a lot of flexibility. Like a lot of the stuff that we're doing, I was doing even before I had tenure. And it's a harder road, but if you're really passionate about it, then it's worth it. You know, in fact, I had someone at my former institution, and I really appreciated this. This was great advice. They said, you know, all this stuff you're doing on education, I mean, this is like not a great quote for academia, but it was someone telling me not how they thought it should be, but just telling me how it was. And they said, you know, all this stuff you're doing on education, they were like, I think that all of that is, you know, absolutely outstanding. But realize that there are a lot of people in our, you know, field in generally, right, nationally, you have to get these tenure letters. There are a lot of people who will see that and think that means, especially because you're a woman, it means you're not serious about your chemistry research. And so not only do you need to make sure that you hit your marks when it comes to research productivity and funding and all of that, but because you're doing this education stuff, not only will it not make up for like research, you actually, your research probably has to be even better for people to take you seriously because you do this education stuff. But they're like, but you should keep doing it because it's really outstanding. And so it's, you know, the field is, yeah, there's a lot of things that aren't great still. And we kind of have to cope with, but at the same time, you know, if you really, there's a whole other psychology of if you find deep meaning in your work, that's really, really protective for kind of our mental health. And so I often say I could do this job in, you know, I could probably maybe do this job in like 40 hours a week, but then I mostly only do the parts that I don't really enjoy. And so the fact that I work more allows me to do, you know, things like being here today and writing columns, writing about these topics and leading in a different way, doing the education research allows me to do a lot of the things I'm really, really passionate about. So then it makes for a job that I find really, really fulfilling in the end.
Thank you so much. And the part you said about women, it just resonates so much. Like, we have to be extra good to be able to sort of expand. And thank you for being such a role model to us in, you know, creating this, like, all the opportunities for yourself and setting a role model for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, let me interrupt for a reminder that we are coming close to 10:40. So we that the webinar will end in 3 minutes or 2 minutes, so we can take one more question.
I had a question. I'll try to make it quick. Thanks for the insight today, Dr. Heemstra. So my question was related to this mindset around failure and career stage and kind of meshing the two. And so thinking specifically about a PhD or a master's, you're on a rather tight timeline sometimes that might not allow as much flexibility for failure as different career stages further on. So I was just wondering how your mindset about failure has changed throughout your career.
Oh, gosh, that's a really interesting question. You know, you're right. There's different tolerance at different times. Though I will say, as a faculty member, I still don't feel a really high tolerance, because if I'm failing at research, that means grad students and postdocs in my lab are failing at research, and they are on that tight timeline and really, really need to succeed. So even if I'm like, oh, we could take on something super high risk and fail and it'd be fine, I know that that's actually not really fine. You know, I think, yeah, for me personally, I won't lie, tenure, and now I'm up for full professor, and that's almost a hopefully done deal. It helps you. I think I'm just as driven as I always was, but I probably relax a little bit more and have more fun, you know, and I feel bad saying that, but I also feel like there's some truth to it. Like, I remember when we got our big grant that I knew we were going to get tenure, I joked with my lab. I was like, wait, what's that feeling? It's like blood is flowing back to my heart again for the first time in 4 years of being an assistant professor and constantly thinking, what if I'm going to get tenure? What if I'm going to get tenure? What if I'm going to get, you know? And so there is some reality to it, but at the same time, I think, you know, and I've definitely, probably what's impacted me more than my career stage is just this mindset, is that, you know, I've been trying to grow, especially over the last 5 years, in this mindset, and that's helped me to view failure a lot differently. Actually, some of it, the thing that's probably been most instructive is a really horrible failure I went through, actually around my tenure decision, and the way that I had to deal with that and how I came out of it really, really fundamentally changed me in ways that nothing else in my life has ever shaped me. So I think for everyone, there's all of these different factors that play into how you view failure, from life experience, your career stage, your own personal growth. But I think at the end of the day, it still all comes back to, no matter how high or low the stakes are, even as the stakes change, we're always going to be more successful if we can have that mindset that, you know, kind of set, you know, that mindset says, okay, well, failure is bad and I don't want to fail, but at least I'm going to accept that as a potential outcome so that I can give it my best shot and be as successful as possible. The people who I think really struggle are the people who are like, failure is not an option. That kind of locks you up into a place where, it actually prevents you from being able to move forward and be successful.
Thank you for the discussion and great questions and great presentation. So now the coffee chat is coming to end, and let us officially end the coffee chat today. And if you have more questions for Professor Heemstra, you can reach out to her via email or Twitter. Actually, her Twitter, as Layla mentioned, her Twitter has a lot of interesting tweets that's updated like every week. So I really enjoy looking at your tweets, and I hope if you are interested, you can follow her on Twitter and follow us on Twitter. That's in our chat box. And thank you all for joining today, and special thanks to Professor Heemstra and Layla for organizing. Hope you enjoyed our first coffee chat, and thank you for joining.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks. That was pretty good what you guys did. Awesome.
Thank you, Professor Kumar.
If the junior CNET people could sit around for a second afterwards.
Absolutely.
So I just wanted to, first of all, awesome job. Thank you so much, everyone.
And can we end the recording before we start?
Yes.